Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all on behalf of IQAC Shyamlal College to this one-day webinar on credibility crisis in media during COVID times. The proposal or the idea of this webinar was conceptualized during a discussion with our resource person for this session, Professor Siddharth Mishra. I welcome you, sir, today here with us in this webinar. I also welcome our principal, sir, Professor Ravi Narayankar, who gave the idea of organizing a webinar on such a pertinent topic, which is which needs some thought-provoking deliberations and discussions so as to understand the role that our media is playing in the times of this global crisis that we as entire humanity are facing. I also welcome all our participants in this webinar. I'm very happy to inform everyone that we had almost over 600 registrations for this particular webinar, which the interests not only the interests and how people really want to hear from a renowned journalist himself about where media stands or what is media's stand during these times, as well as, you know, we have seen in other previous crisis times or important events in the world as well as in India, how media has fared. So this webinar is, again, I would like to inform all our participants, is one in the series of conferences and virtual mode interactions that we have been having since March, when India went into a lockdown, and we have been trying to keep our faculty, students, stakeholders, and other academics engaged and through this platform. We are very happy to inform that we have had great conferences, webinars, and workshops through the virtual medium with great participation from people all over the country. In this webinar also, we have had people coming from South India as well as Maharashtra and other states who have, you know, who registered for this specific webinar. Before I go further, I would like to say a few words about the topic that we have chosen. We realize that, you know, we've been seeing, all of us, the intelligentsia specifically, how the face of media and the conduct of media has changed over several decades. We are no longer living in the era of Doordarshan, where we used to have only, you know, half an hour news twice a day, and we would get to know about major things happening around the world. Now is the time when we have 24-hour news channels. We have media houses running their channels on Facebook and online portals. So we are continuously updated with all information, all kinds of information, whether it's required or it's not required. And in the meantime, we may also miss out on some important developments happening around the world because media actually chooses to cater to the needs of specific sections of society. Basically, maybe it's specific sections of society. It comes across as biased sometimes. It comes across as it practices a selective exclusion sometimes. and specifically in COVID times, you know, it becomes really it becomes really funny. I would use that word funny when they call themselves, all of them call themselves Corona warriors. So I really want to ask, what kind of a war or fight against Corona are they fighting? You know, when they're comparing themselves to the soldiers who are there on the border, they're comparing themselves to the doctors who are, you know, the frontline workers who are who are actually dealing with COVID cases day and night, and are also putting their lives in dangers. Of course, there are media personnel who have put their lives in dangers in many situations. But this kind of self-gloating is what we see on televisions as well as on online portals. And most disturbing is there is one specific incident which has come to light. You know, a very sad news which we have got to hear is the suicide of this budding actor Sushant Singh Rajput, and how, you know, there are a lot of news coming in that you know, media also to a certain extent played a role, you know, in the sense, you know, bringing him down, because he was called psychotic, he was pulled down, there were media representatives who had joined you know, these Bollywood camps in order to pull a young actor down who had no godfather in the industry. I don't know how far that is true, but this kind of news is also coming in, so that's very disappointing. There are positive aspects also. I am hoping that our resource person of the day, Professor Mishra, is going to highlight a lot of factors that contribute to media being biased or unbiased, and how media is doing during these times. I would like to introduce our eminent speaker to the audience, as though he's a well-known journalist and professor. Professor Siddharth Mishra is the chairperson and adjunct professor at Vivekananda School of Journalism and Mass Communication, IP University. He has been the PIB accredited journalist. He is the president of Center for Reforms, Development and Justice. He has been the visiting faculty to IIMC New Delhi. He is the editor of UGC listed journal, The Discussant. He is also the editor and CEO of Capital Khabar. He is the consulting editor of Millennium Post. He is a senior editor and thereafter associate editor of The Pioneer. He has also been associated with Hindustan Times as reporter in the initial years of his career. And he has had a lot of other academic and research assignments, and he has visited several countries during those academic and research assignments. For example, he has been to Dublin, Ireland. He has been to Taiwan. And he has also been associated with the Indian Military Academy and Rashtriya Indian Military College, Dehradun. He was also part of the first Indian delegation that visited Afghanistan. It was led by the then Foreign Secretary, Kamal Sibal. He has also been to Kuwait, and he has supervised research as well. So it's a very multi-talented personality that we have among us today. He has also been part of the UNID study group visiting Uganda. He has held several administrative positions also. He has been the elected member of Delhi University Court, chairman governing body of several Delhi University colleges, including Shivaji College, Shaheed Bhagat Singh College, and Maharaja Agrasen College. He has had several publications also. He has published books. The most recent one is Delhi Political, 1947 to 2013. It's a very, very interesting. It's a very, very interesting outcome of his research. He has contributed to several books. He has contributed chapters and essays to several books. And he has a very active career in journalism even now, and also is contributing to the academics with his experience in the field of media. Thank you, sir, for joining us today and sparing time for our college. Like always, we always request you, and you never disappoint us. Thank you so much. I would also like to say a few words about our principal, Professor Abhi Narayankar, who has always been, you know, it is he who's behind all these initiatives that we have been taking in the college. And specifically, it is he who actually has gotten us in touch with all these eminent resource persons and academics. And one of them is here with us today, Professor Mishra. Thank you, sir. Thank you. With your academic guidance as well as leadership, we have been able to achieve a lot during these 5 years that we have been that we have had you with us. Thank you. I would request our principal to give the welcome address. Thank you.
Good afternoon to everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, madam, for your kind words. On behalf of Shyamalal family, I extend a very, very warm welcome to our distinguished chief speaker of the day, Professor Siddharth Mishra, and all the participants from different parts of India and abroad. And some of our students have also joined, and my dear colleagues. Let me congratulate IQSE, led by Dr. Kusha, for taking this initiative in organizing a very, very pertinent webinar on credibility crisis in media during the times of COVID. We know that we have before us the distinguished speaker and who has vast experience of over 3 decades in Indian media. And now he has become a practitioner also and teaching in a very prestigious institution. But at the same time, all of us have suddenly, when the lockdown was announced, all of us are exposed to the Indian media. And the time we have been spending before the electronic media, and that has totally exposed us to different types of news and other stuff appearing before us. So that has given us a lot of food for thought, even what Dr. Kusha was also describing. All of us has every day, at times we are feeling, you know, a lot of things would have been presented in a better way. A lot of news we wanted to look at, it is missing. And a lot of things, because all of us are also growing, and we have seen how the Indian media and particularly the television media has transformed in the last 3 decades, and at least in the 2.5 decades when the privatization happened and a lot of channels started flocking in. But definitely, as the topic of the today, I won't deal much on that. The wording is the credibility crisis, because at times also we just wonder whether the media is looking at. If I put it very, very frankly, sir, before you, is it the entertainment quotient that is what they want to highlight? Our journalists now that are being trained to become actors, where is the content? So that is why these questions start pouring in, the credibility questions. I won't take much time. Sir, we have been all the time blessed to have whenever there is a need. So we always bank upon you, and who else can, you know, be a better speaker for today's occasion other than you. So with these words, once again, I congratulate our IQSE, and I once again extend a very, very warm welcome to Professor Siddharth Mishra. And at the same time also, I'm really overwhelmed by the participation of more than 250 right now. I could see, and a lot of people are waiting in the waiting room also. I am very, very thankful for joining and endeavoring in the joining in the family of SLC. So the flag, let the flag fly high. With these words, I'm ending here and over to Professor Mishra.
Thank you, Professor Kar. Thank you, Kusha. I can say that I'm master of none of the arts that you have said. I'm jack of all trades. And All my life, I have tried to do things, you know, whichever I have found inquisitive. As far as my, you know, metamorphosis of becoming into an academician and researcher, a lot of credit goes to Professor R.N. Kar and Shyamlal College, you know, because you have had me over for so many conferences and seminars. And much before I became a full-time professor, and as the want is, you know, that one would always want that wherever I went, wherever I go, I want that I should be able to give my best to the, what you call, to the deliberation. And this has helped me in my growth as a, you know, academician, if you can say, as a researcher, academician, whatever. So, the introduction itself has created so much of crisis of credibility for media today. Media is passing through a very, very torrid time, and this torrid time is largely because COVID, which has attacked this universe, which has attacked this planet in a way that nobody ever thought, that COVID has, you know, created a situation where all the big and the small, the rich and the poor, the feudal lords and the serfs, they all have been brought on the same level as far as the threat of life goes. Today, or the threat of health goes, if I can put it that way. Why be so paranoid about it? And, so that is the biggest achievement of COVID, that nobody expected it to be. And so when everybody is brought on the same plane, what happens? That your accountability increases. And you find yourself to be accountable to a large section of people about whom you never thought earlier. So the same kind of situation has arisen today. And you see, what Dr. Tiwari and what Professor Kar mentioned about traits of media, they are the symptoms. And as in case of corona, there are symptomatic cases and there are asymptomatic cases. So this disease was, the problems in media were always there. They were there for quite some time, but they were largely asymptomatic. But COVID has made this crisis symptomatic, that we are now seeing the symptoms very, very clearly, because we are today scrutinizing media very, very closely. And how are we scrutinizing media that very closely? Because we have increased our consumption level of information. We are seeking information. A lot of information we are seeking. So this consumption level of information has gone up. So that has, when you consume more, it's like this, that if when you go to a restaurant and you have a menu card before you, you know, and you have so many things laid out before you, you're very choosy about what to do. And then when you have the choice and if the thing does not turn out to be good, you call the chef and say that it was not good. So similarly, here in case of media, the consumption levels have gone up. People have a lot of time to spend on following the media. And therefore, media scrutiny has gone up. And because of media scrutiny going up, media accountability has gone up. And more importantly, most importantly, the symptoms of illness which had been plaguing our media scenario for last so many years has become evident. Now this creates a situation of contradiction. Because as I said before, that, you know, in the multi-pronged war against COVID, media is playing a very important role, if not an important, very huge, very big role, because tools of media, tools of communication are being used in our fight against COVID. Awareness, to create awareness, to send messages, informations. So the question arises that when the tools of media is so much being sought after in times of COVID, why has this question of crisis risen at all? This should have been the boom time of Indian media. The Indian media has had a boom time for last two decades or so, So they should have taken the boom, the graphs of profit to a greater height. But that is not happening. And what is happening is the first thing which comes to my mind, which I want to talk about, is the crisis of survival. I will largely limit myself to the Indian context, and my focus of area of study is also Indian context. Although I do refer to foreign media here and there, but I largely feel that the context of Indian media, because Indian media is the biggest media in the world, and the consumers of Indian media is also the biggest mass in the world. So if we are able to understand the Indian media well, we will be able to understand the global media also. That's not much of an issue. So I'll try to focus myself on the Indian media. Till about 10 days back, when I last took the figures, there had been 50 instances of setback for media industry in general and media persons in particular ever since the lockdown. And when I mention setbacks, it includes shutting down of regional editions of several major newspapers, including prominent brands like the Telegraph, the Hindustan Times, and the Times of India, among others. Among the major television news network, the India Today Group has decided to cease operation of Delhi Aaj Tak. In addition to this, all instances of several senior journalists either being asked to resign or not seek renewal of their service contracts. Now, this is certainly a reflection towards crisis of survival. So the crisis in print media primarily, and to an extent in the television media, was summed up in an interview to CNBC by Ms. Shobhna Bhartia, who is the chairperson of HT Media, Hindustan Times Group, as you called it. In the interview, she said that though the consumption of content may have increased during the period of the lockdown, the advertisement revenue has taken a big hit. There could not be a more caustic situation. You see, consumption of news has gone up, but the advertisements have fallen, and that's why Indian media is today facing this crisis of survival. So here was the first disease, major disease, that Indian media was largely pushed by advertisement. And what was advertisement doing? Advertisement was subsidizing the cost of printing a newspaper. Ordinarily, you are getting a newspaper for 2 rupees or 3 rupees, whereas it cost anything about 15 to 20 rupees in printing one copy of newspaper. So these advertisements were subsidizing your cost. With the advertisements gone, media houses are finding it very, very difficult to run the newspapers. And there is a similarity between what is happening in Indian media industry and what happened in Delhi. This whole idea of subsidizing power, water, transport created a situation that when income stopped, when businesses stopped, when revenue stopped coming, you had no money to sustain your hospitals, to sustain your nursing staff, to sustain your other services. And today, if I am not wrong, for all, except for the fact that we still have a state government in place, but for all practical purposes, Delhi has been taken over by central government. So this whole idea, we Indians have this problem. Media is, after all, a mirror of the society that it functions in. So we Indians have this problem of enjoying subsidies. Koi amma canteen chahta hai, koi Indra canteen chahta hai, koi 2 rupaye mein idli chahta hai, koi, that is the way our whole thing. And votes are given for that I can get some good cheap idli, or I can get some 2 square meals, or I can get a free ride in the bus. So these are the issues which dictate our elections, our politics. So similarly, when we were reading newspapers, when we read newspapers, and what are the, what you call, tools which the newspaper houses have been using. You launched a newspaper, you came out with a subscription drive, and you said, pay for 2 years subscription drive, and we will give you, so it works out to about, say, 4,000 rupees. So we'll give you a pair of Reebok shoes and a set of blankets and a quilt. So it all turns out to be about 5,000 rupees. So you're still in profit of 1,000 rupees. So you paid that 4,000 rupees, took the shoes, took the blanket, and newspapers came in as bonus. So the whole economics of Indian media industry was run like this. The print media industry largely. So when the advertisements are gone, when the advertisers are gone, the newspapers are gone. And why are the advertisers going? Why are the newspapers not selling? Newspapers not what you call circulating? It is because in these times when, you know, after touching everything, you are using the spray, and after, you know, you're using a stick to push a lift button, when, you know, that social distancing touch, and you're not, when, you know, you're sanitizing everything which is coming to your house and everything. So who would take the guarantee or the newspapers which come to you, not directly from the press, but through a distribution stand and a newspaper hawker and such people, the guarantee of it being clean, it being corona-free? तो पहले दिमाग में बात तो ये आ गई कि भाई ये कोरोना फ्री है नहीं है. सो हाफ ऑफ द पीपल वेंट अवे दैट, नंबर वन. नंबर टू, देयर वाज लॉकडाउंस, देयर वर लॉकडाउंस. बट वेयर आई एम स्पीकिंग टू यू फ्रॉम टुडे, माय हाउस, वी आर स्टेइंग इन अ टावर इन कौशाम्बी व्हिच इज अंडर सील टुडे. आई कैन नॉट गो बियॉन्ड द लिफ्ट रिसेप्शन ऑफ माय सोसाइटी टुडे. सो देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन ऑन न्यूज़पेपर्स कमिंग टू माय हाउस. एंड आउट ऑफ द 10 टावर्स इन सोसाइटी, ईच टावर हैविंग अबाउट 100 फ्लैट्स, 1,000 flats, I think 8 towers are today under sea. So newspapers are not coming. Even if newspapers arrive, they cannot be distributed. The hawkers will not be allowed in the building. In India's financial capital, the newspapers distribution was allowed by the government only around 7th or 8th of June. So when the circulation vanishes, when newspapers are not being circulated, why would businesses advertise? Point number one. And point number two, you advertise when there are businesses. When all other businesses are shut, you know, when there are no surfs being bought, when there are no tide powder being bought across the shelf, you know, people are going and buying things, you know, in desperation, not really caring what brand, what this thing. Soap lena hai to wo not necessarily mehsoor sandal lo. Koi bhi soap mil jaye le lo. कुछ भी मिल जाए ले लो. सो देर इज, सो यू नो, इन सच काइंड ऑफ सिचुएशन एडवर्टाइजर इज नॉट रियली लुकिंग, इज नॉट रियली लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू एडवर्टाइज हिज प्रोडक्ट्स. हिज प्रोडक्ट्स आर सेलिंग लाइक दिस. नो, इट्स अ रिवर्स काइंड ऑफ इकोनॉमी बूम फॉर सम पीपल. गिलोय टैबलेट्स वेयर आई डोंट रिकॉल एनी ऑफ द व्हाट यू कॉल फार्मेसी हाउसेस, अदर देन मिस्टर Swami Ramdev's Patanjali, ever advertising that they made Giloy tablets. But today, it is selling off the shelf. Himalaya, which is a very old and very reputed and accredited Ayurvedic medicine manufacturing company, when one went and checked on that, one realized that they also make Giloy tablets, and they have been making it for years. They never advertise. And today, when you go and in fact, you go and check on their website, out of the 7 days, 4 days, they would be out of stock. But that is the way it is being bought. So when the things are being bought off the shelf, when there's lot of goods during pandemic, which have come in so much in demand, where is the need to advertise? And there are certain things which cannot be bought during this period. So how do you advertise? Why do you advertise? So in both the situation, the question of advertising goes. And when the question of advertising goes, there are no revenues coming to the newspapers, and the crisis will arise in the newspaper. Because all this while newspapers have worked on a advertisement subsidiary model, which is now proving to be non-productive. What are the losses which the newspapers are facing today? These figures have been given by, which I'm going to share with you, have been given by Indian Newspaper Society, which is the apex body of newspaper industry, print media industry. And it says that it has suffered a loss of nearly rupees 4,500 crores in the months of March and April on account of the lack of advertisements. The industry is likely to suffer further losses of rupees 15,000 crore over the next 7 months. So if we take this corona cycle to be of around 9 months period, the whole loss would be of about rupees 20,000 crore. So rupees 20,000 crore, which was to come to print media industry, is lost. If that is lost, the survival, the whole crisis of survival starts. But I must tell you something. There is crisis for survival. There is crisis for survival in media industry. There are crisis for survival in other industries. The crisis of survival happens at many places. If we read our history, many a times crisis of survival has happened. And people always find a way out. A model for revival always evolves out of the crisis. And in case of media industry also, the print media industry also, that financial survival model would evolve. I'm very sure media is not going to die or be dead by the end of corona, but there will be change in the prescriptions, but it's going to survive. What is the biggest concern with me today is crisis of credibility. Because people are, now let us see from the other side, the reader's point of view, if the newspapers are not coming, people are not really worried, they have that smartphone in their hand. And smartphone gives you, probably that broadsheet gave you one newspaper or two newspaper. The smartphone gives you time to read 12 newspapers, 15 newspapers, news portals, television screens and everything. So consumption, as Mrs. Bhartia also said, the consumption of information has gone up, but still the crisis of credibility. She was talking about crisis of survival. I will talk about crisis of credibility. Now, first and foremost, I'm not going to hold corona villain for the crisis of credibility which is being suffered by Indian media. This crisis of credibility has not been thrust on the Indian media by COVID-19. It has been seeping into it for some time. There have been circumstances, many factors. Some have been of its own making. Some have been, there have been attempts by government to subjugate it, attempted by other factors to subjugate it, and some have been of their own making. So one by one, I will discuss those factors with you. The first thing which I want to discuss with you is media management and influence peddling. In a democratic setup, media is the fourth state, goes without saying, which essentially has been assigned the role of a watchdog. Nazar rakhna hai sabke upar. Everything is happening fine or not. However, with ever-increasing market influence, the sloth of media management lurking over the media industry has only become deeper and darker. Market, advertiser, when he's pumping so much money into media, he actually wants a return for it. So he starts doing what's called media management, right? Now, but this media management that I mentioned to you is not to be confused. How media management is used as a term in the discipline of management and mass communication. In academic terms, it is an interdisciplinary research area devoted to study how media organizations use scarce resources to meet the needs and wants of a given society. In other words, it is interested in effective management of media outlets. Now, when you talk about effective management of media outlets, probably ethics does not play a very big role there. Financial viability is the deciding factor in case of media management, right? Okay, that's a management concept. From mass communication point of view, there is another concept, and that is, earlier one was media management, more of a management concept. The one which I'm going to tell you now is more of a mass communication concept, that is managing media. Managing media has a very different connotation. Managing media is closer to the term media relations, where public relation firms work hand in hand with media disseminating information available to the client. जो बड़े बड़े कॉर्पोरेट हाउसेस और सरकार जो एडवर्टाइजमेंट देती है, द पीपल हु एडवर्टाइज इन द न्यूज़पेपर्स आल्सो ऑन द अदर हैंड यूज द सर्विसेज ऑफ द पब्लिक रिलेशंस प्रेस पब्लिक रिलेशन एजेंसीज टू पुश द इंफॉर्मेशन फ्रॉम देम एंड मेनी अ टाइम्स द पब्लिक रिलेशन एजेंसीज प्ले फैसिलिटेटर इन द रिलीज ऑफ एडवर्टाइजमेंट एंड रेवेन्यू टू द मीडिया हाउसेस. But do we blame this public relation agencies for the dishonesty which is coming into media? There's a very famous English-born American scientist and essayist, Graham Paul. He says, of the stories you read in traditional media that aren't about politics, crimes, or disasters, more than half probably comes from PR firms. A story which is not related to politics, crime, or disaster, more than half probably comes from PR firms. He's talking in terms of Western world, not in the terms of Indian world. In his seminal essay titled Submarine, Paul writes, PR is not dishonest, not quite. If anyone is dishonest, it is the reporters. The main reason PR firms exist is that reporters are lazy. Or to put it more nicely, overworked. Really, they ought to be out there digging up stories for themselves. But it's so tempting to sit in their offices and let PR firms bring the stories to them. After all, they know good PR firms won't lie to them. Now, here comes in the problem. That you would not go and dig the stories. You would rather wait for the PR firms to give you the stories and use their press releases. A very well-made press release lands at your desk in the evening. You just have to change a word here and one there and push as your story. So this laziness in the reporters, and as Graham Paul says, this dishonesty in the reporters has led to this crisis of credibility. Now, coming to the Indian context, over the past three decades, there has been an upsurge in the number of PR or media relation firms. Huge number of PR firms and media relation firms have come up. A large number of journalists over a period of time have quit their job to join the PR industry. But unlike Paul's claim of PR companies working in the areas of news other than politics, crime, and disaster, Paul कहते हैं कि PR firms work in the areas other than politics, crime, and disaster. The Indian firms have worked overtime in these very three areas, politics, crime, and disasters, especially when the newfound zeal for developing a positive narratives, which at times could be an euphemism for false narrative, has started. Whole time is being spent. You see, politics, crime, disaster, these are things which have to do with day-to-day human life. And there are armies of people, you know, narrative creators on both sides of the Rubicon who are creating narratives. And these narratives, positive narrative for their clients. And many a times, these positive narratives end up being false narrative, as we have seen in many cases in the past. Even the government, and this is not only true for private firms, Even the governments have also not been averse to employ, if not the companies, at least a few professionals as full-time advisors, consultants. Governments are also known to have informal but very powerful relation with journalists and influential media persons, which at times is also known to dictate formation of union cabinet. Media persons are playing a go-between in the formation of government. One aspirant for a position in the government tells a media person who's supposed to be close to the establishment of the party that, you know, please push my case. And these are not hollow allegations. There was a case, the case in point is the Radia tape issue. These leaked tapes contain conversations between journalists and lobbyists to influence formation of UPA 2 government. It firmly established the role played by influential media persons as influence peddlers, media management influence peddlers, which till then was only talked about in hush tones. Tab tak chupchap baat karte the. Ye uska kareeb hai, ye uska kareeb hai. He can get the thing there. Here it was now established. But look, these are the people who are the one who are the influence peddlers. Thus, when the phenomena of managing media seeps deep into democratic setup, the first casualty is dissent. Media's primary role is to be the dissenter against the establishment. Stand up to the establishment and tell the establishment that you are wrong. The role of a nindak, as Kabir would say, the critique. But when you are into such influence peddling, you probably cannot play that role of critique. And this was not just limited to the 10, 12, 14, 20 people whose name figured in this tape. All Indian media establishment decided to keep quiet on the matter. And in a report dated November 23, 2010, International Business Tribune wrote, Indian media is now running for cover. The 2G spectrum scam, which has snowballed into a major controversy involving Indian politicians and businessmen, has now become hotter for journalists to handle as it allegedly involves two of their senior members. Two Indian magazines put the audio tapes, Open Magazine, then headed by a person called Manu Joseph, and Outlook, then headed by legendary Vinod Mehta. Two Indian magazines put the audio tapes and transcripts of the conversation between corporate lobbyist Neera Wadia of Vaishnavi Communications and her media friends on their websites. Other media houses decided to hush it. So when media is not talking about itself and its own problems, the erosion of trust in press starts. The erosion of trust in media starts. This erosion of trust could have been arrested if the media houses would have come out criticizing the acts of these media persons. But they did not do. Not only that, unfortunately, some of whose names figured even today continue to wield positions of influence in the arena of mass communication. Let's, however, be very clear, it's not only the cases of financial impropriety which has bordered media structures in these years. Financial impropriety, influence peddling, but that is not the only problem which has, you know, kind of bothered Indian media structures. The other big factor which comes to my mind is gender harassment. One of the major issues which has created anxious moments are cases of sexual harassment. The two major instances are that of Tarun Tejpal, a former editor-in-chief of Tehelka magazine, and MJ Akbar, the much celebrated author, writer, lawmaker, and a former minister. Tarun Tejpal was accused in November 2013 by a journalist working in Tehelka magazine of sexual assault during a media conclave in there were irrefutable evidences against him, and he tried to buy peace by admitting misconduct and offering to take 6 months leave from Tehalka to do penance. Now, come on. You commit a crime under IPC and you want to do penance. You commit a crime under IPC and you decide to do penance. Why not face law? So this is where the problems of Indian media starts. That you ask for justice, you ask for so many things, you ask for this thing, but when it comes to you, you decide to do penance. However, this did not cut much ice with the police, and a case of rape was registered. He was arrested and sent to jail. The matter is still pending before the court. You see, again, 2013 का केस है, आज 2020 हो गया, इस केस में जजमेंट इसलिए नहीं आ पाया अभी तक कि तरुण तेजपाल has used services of best of the lawyers and he has fought till Supreme Court that this FIR should be quashed against him. Now Supreme Court has finally sent the case back to the trial court and let's see what is the outcome. But he has been able to delay the prosecution in the case for 7 years. And did you ever hear any media house going to town saying that he is doing this? Jessica Lal case mein aap chalega town mein. This is happening, that is happening. Any other case which involves a politician or a corporate house, you shout from the top of the roof. But in your case, I'm asking the participants, did anybody ever read in the newspapers that Mr. Tarun Tejpal was using services of best of the lawyers in the country to delay his prosecution? So therein lies the problem. And the irony is that Mr. Tejpal's Tehalka magazine was to hold media trials like anything. And in the same year, in 2013, when he was prosecuted, when he was, FIR was launched against him for in the same year, in February month, they had brought out he had a reputation of whistleblower. He was exposed people. And he has exposed gender exploitation in various offices, corporate houses. But when it came to his own, but what was he doing? He was pontificating all the while, but practicing what? So as T.S. Eliot would have said, that between the preaching and the practice, there lies a shadow, not just a shadow, a very, very long shadow. So that was the case of Mr. Tarun Tejpal. Now the case of Mr. M.G. Akbar. The fall from grace of much powerful editor, lawmaker M.G. Akbar also contributed its bit in the erosion of trust in the Indian media. Following the Me Too movement in the United States and spread of its influence across the globe, several colleagues of Akbar who had worked with him at different points of time over a long journey as nation's leading journalists accused him of sexual harassment, including rape. Skeletons tumbled out of the cupboard one after another. And this forced the Prime Minister Narendra Modi to seek Akbar's resignation from Council of Ministers. Even at, Mr. Modi does not easily give in to the criticism of press and opposition. But here in this case, he had to give in. Mr. Akbar had to resign and go. Now these cases, and there are some other lesser known cases, have besmirched the reputation of Indian media of being clean and being espousers of ethical values. The aforementioned instances indicate towards travel of Indian media from being watchdog to that of compradors, as the comrades would say, compradors, having started to lose on their ability to dissent, the ability to disagree with the policies, methods, and goals of political party or government, taking an opposing view to a prevailing idea or an entity. When you are morally compromised, when you are financially compromised, dissent kaise hoga? पैसे सब कर ही नहीं सकते, यू विल बी आर्म ट्विस्टेड. सो what the media starts doing is starts consenting from being dissenting to starts being consenting. That's the antonym. American linguist and political activist Noam Chomsky defined consent vis-a-vis dissent. In 1988, Edward Herman and Noam Chomsky wrote a book titled Manufacturing Consent, The Political Economy of the Mass Media. The authors claim in the tome that the mass communication media of US were effective and powerful ideological institutions that carry out a system supportive propaganda function by reliance on market forces. He was talking in context of American media. In fact, till that time, Indian media was not as large or big as it is today. So that is the pre-opening of the economy years. That this came out in 1988. Till then, the opening of the economy had not happened in India, and the media was also having a limited spread and limited influence. Later, this definition was further delineated in a documentary made in the year 1992, which was titled Manufacturing Consent, Noam Chomsky and the Media. And it presented what came to be identified as propaganda model of communication, which also dealt in depth with the politics of mass communication business. In the Indian context, this model becomes very relevant now that we have opened up. And very relevant, as what we are witnessing is a change in form, structure and character from vigorously autonomous entity to propaganda model. Media becoming tools of propaganda, ये मुझे कोई proof करने की ज़रूरत नहीं है. You all agree to it. The opening comments touched on the issue. So from being vigorously dissenting autonomous entity, the media today is becoming a consenting entity in this country, and turning into following the propaganda model. When I say propaganda model, it may necessarily not be for government, but also for the rivals of the government. Koi A party ka propaganda, koi B party ka propaganda, koi C party ka propaganda. But all of them are into business of propaganda. Now, when everybody is into the business of propaganda, question may arise that is there a need for media, autonomous media at all? I would say yes. Despite all his weaknesses, all his illness, we need to have autonomous media. We are a democracy. We are not China, where People's Weekly and World News are the papers which gives you information with the government center. We need to have structures where people will continue to, and we have such a great legacy. Our freedom struggle has been full of the role of media. So this may be a period of aberration where people have got into propagandist role because of those several reasons, but there is need for course correction and there is need for having autonomous media. And I would again underline that as somebody had quoted in a research paper, it says that an independent media is important so that the reported facts, figures and stories can be believed and trusted as the truth. When people get information from independent sources, they are persuaded to think decisively and form their own opinions, thus making independent media a vital clog for a democratic setup. Agar aapke paas इंफॉर्मेशन ही मैनिपुलेटेड आएगा, फैक्ट्स फिगर्स मैनिपुलेटेड आएंगे, तो आपकी थिंकिंग मैनिपुलेट. इसीलिए इट इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर अस टू हैव इंडिपेंडेंट मीडिया, टू अलाउ आवर डेमोक्रेसी टू रिमेन हेल्दी, टू रिमेन इन गुड शेप, टू रिमेन वाइब्रेंट. But it's a fact that our media is not in that good health, and so is our democracy. What could be the reasons for crisis? We have been, you know, in the generally we have talked about so many issues, and we, not only in this deliberation but outside it also, early in other places also. Some say government is finishing it. Some says advertisers are finishing it. I would try to articulate this for you. To my understanding, why we are not having a very, very autonomous and a fair and a vigilant media today is there are about four or five reasons for it. And the first reason is government regulation or lack of it. You know, government ki charcha bahut hoti hai. Media ka gala marod raha hai government, media ka control kar raha hai government aur media ko. So we must first discuss this. There are four mediums or podia which the government recognized today as media platforms. This is largely based, and now how does this recognition comes? This is largely based on the fact that the media persons working with these platforms are recognized through a very elaborate system of accreditation through the Press Information Bureau under the Ministry of INB, Information and Broadcasting. Similarly, the Ministry of INB through another arm, Bureau of Outreach and Communication, which in the earlier avatar was known as Directorate of Audiovisual Publicity, DAVP, controls release of revenue from government to media houses through release of advertisements. The four recognized media platforms, jinke journalists ko accreditation milta hai access ke liye aur jinko revenue milti hai, are newspapers, radio, television and news portals, and they together can be said to be constituting the organized media sector. However, on the other hand, with the rise of social media platforms, especially YouTube channels, the growth of unorganized media sector too has been phenomenal. So the government can regulate the organized media. The government can control the organized media. How will the government control the unorganized media? We will, you know, now that we have, before we move ahead, we'll discuss somewhat about, you know, the different media platforms, the print, the radio, the television, but how can government really control them? The newspapers and radio are legacy of the colonial period, and our colonial rulers created a detailed regulation system for the control of these two mediums. In the case of radio, private news broadcast is still not allowed, as news broadcast continues to be monopoly of All India Radio. आपने नहीं सुना होगा कि जितने ये एफएम चैनल्स हैं वो न्यूज के कुछ पॉइंटर्स वगैरह देते हैं, लेकिन एंटरटेनमेंट चैनल्स है, न्यूज अभी भी रेडियो, न्यूज अभी भी ऑल इंडिया रेडियो की मोनोपोली है. दे डोंट अलाउ एनीबॉडी एल्स टू लुक इनटू इट. सो रेडियो न्यूज इज कंप्लीटली कंट्रोल्ड बाई गवर्नमेंट. The newspapers, though privately owned, are regulated through a process of registration with Registrar of Newspapers in India and certain other laws which control issue of licenses to the printing presses. In addition to this, there is the provision of Press Council of India for redressing grievances against newspapers, and also newspaper publications are covered by various defamation and libel laws. So newspaper ke upar kafi bandish hai. एक वो ब्रिटिश लेगेसी थी, वर्णापुरा प्रेस एक्ट, प्रेस फ्रीडम एक्ट, रॉलेट एक्ट, जिसने फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल में जो न्यूज़पेपर्स का कंट्रीब्यूशन था उसको कंट्रोल करने के लिए बहुत एक्ट लगा. बट यू नो आवर यू नो दैट वाज द टाइम व्हेन इन अगेन इन मास कम्युनिकेशन, इंडियन मास कम्युनिकेशन जर्नलिज्म, दैट वाज द एरा ऑफ रिबेलियस पेन, बागी कलम. पीपल ऑलवेज फाउंड आउट वेज टू सबवर्ट द ब्रिटिश लॉज, टू कम आउट विद देयर राइट अप्स एंड राइटिंग्स. But and also to avoid laws getting prosecuted and things like that. So there is that legacy which also brought in certain amount of responsibility also into what you call among the media persons. So thus the newspapers have over a period of time have evolved what's called a more responsible genre of journalism, which, however, is not to be confused with propaganda journalism, responsible journalism. You are not enter into an act of character assassination. You are not enter into an act of, you know, unsubstantiated news. That is responsible journalism. The newspapers for several years now have from pre-independence era to present day have worked as watchdogs. The governments of late have, and when I say governments, I don't just mean central government, the governments in the states, and I just mean don't mean government of one political party, governments of several political parties. The governments of late have worked towards curbing autonomy through preferred rather than an objective media plan for the release of advertising revenue. The preference, it goes without saying, is for such media houses which supports its plans and policies. This is reflected in several highly circulated newspapers not finding a place in the government's advertising list from time to time. Newspapers with huge, circulation figures sometimes miss out on government advertisement. You wonder why government advertisement is not there. Because they are being, it's a way that government is reprimanding them for probably taking a stance which is not very, very palatable to the government. Television news. We have discussed radio news. We have discussed newspaper. Now, television news, like radio news too, was a monopoly of government till 1995. When the Supreme Court bench of Justice P.B. Sawant and Justice S. Mohan delivered a judgment in the case between Union of India and Cricket Association of Bengal, which said that airwaves are not a monopoly of the government. Airwaves are not monopoly of the government. This heralded the dawning of private television news channels in this country. उन्होंने ये बात कहा कि airwaves जो है वो government की monopoly नहीं है, ये public की property है. और जब ये decision आया Justice Mohan का और Justice Sawant का, उसके बाद ये जितने production houses थे दूरदर्शन के, all the production houses of दूरदर्शन, they overnight became media channels. Aaj Tak was a production house, NDTV was a production house, all these were production houses of Doordarshan, and they all became media channels, right? The Supreme Court order, unfortunately, remained largely silent on the nitty-gritty of regulation of television news. Unka kaam bhi nahi tha. Unhone bataya ki ye monopoly nahi hai government. ये था उनका ऑर्डर का लिमिटेड स्कोप. उन्होंने इसको रेगुलेट कैसे करना है इसके बारे में कुछ नहीं बताया. और उसका हश्र क्या हुआ, व्हाट वाज़ द फॉलोआउट? इनफैक्ट द ऑर्डर सेड दैट टेलीविजन शुड नॉट कुड नॉट बी एक्सटेंड इट सेड दैट टेलीविजन शुड नॉट बी कंफ्यूज्ड विद प्रेस. इट इंश्योर्ड दैट एंड दिस व्हेन इट सेड दैट टेलीविजन शुड नॉट बी कंफ्यूज्ड विद प्रेस, it probably meant about entertainment and whole lot of things, you know, but news wo unhone koi exclude nahi kiya. When he said television should not be confused with press, what he meant that television also has components of what you call entertainment and such things. But and it was, in fact, this whole case was about telecast of cricket matches, so probably it was saying in that context, but it came to be interpreted in the context of news also, that airwaves are not monopoly of the government, so news can be interpreted. And so Supreme Court never thought ki unko koi regulation banana hai television news ke liye. Rather, unke order mein ek baat kahi gayi that it should not be confused with press. And this was again interpreted that the regulatory authorities for the regulatory laws for the press could not be extended to television. Now, this lack of regulation in many ways have proved to be counterproductive for the growth of TV news. Absence of regulation meant absence of structure for proper accreditation and also release of advertisement to these media houses, which in turn made them greatly dependent on private advertising, and thus the race for gathering television rating points, TRPs, began. जब वो कोई रिकॉग्नाइज नहीं थे गवर्नमेंट से, कोई एक कोई रेवेन्यू स्ट्रक्चर नहीं था गवर्नमेंट से उनको एडवर्टीजमेंट कुछ आने का, तो वो फिर एडवर्टीजमेंट के रैट रेस में आ गए. और एडवर्टीजमेंट का रैट रेस कैसे था, जिनकी ज्यादा टीआरपी उनको ज्यादा एडवर्टीजमेंट, तो वो अट्रैक्ट करने के लिए टीआरपीज को, टीआरपी को शोर करने के लिए दे स्टार्टेड ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ न्यूज, स्नेक मैरिजेस इन रेनी सीजन, फ्रॉग मैरिजेस, and all that kind of thing started finding space in the news channels in the name of news. And this was done to gain on viewership, to gain on TRPs, so that advertisements would come. Now this adversely affected the objectivity quotient in television news, which is largely identified now with highly opinionated debates and discussions that broadcast of the news bulletin, then broadcast of the news bulletins. जब दूरदर्शन था तो न्यूज बुलेटिन थे, जब दूरदर्शन था तो 9 बजे लोग न्यूज देखते थे. आज के समय में 9 बजे प्राइम टाइम में डिबेट्स होते, और उन डिबेट्स में क्या क्या होते, लास्ट टाइम वन हर्ड वाज दैट दैट स्पोक्स पर्सन ऑफ वन पार्टी वाज गोइंग टू हैंग द स्पोक्स पर्सन ऑफ अदर पार्टी फ्रॉम द फैन. और ये बात शायद लोगों ने देखा भी नहीं होगा, लेकिन उस जो न्यूज चैनल का प्रमोटर है उसने उसके क्लिप बना करके उसको पब्लिक डोमेन में छोड़ दिया, सो दैट यू नो पीपल सी इट ऑन व्हाट्सएप, पीपल सी इट ऑन हियर एंड देयर, एंड सो दैट इट गेन्स ऑन टीआरपीस, इट गेन्स ऑन क्लिक्स. सो दैट इज व्हाट टेलीविजन न्यूज इज ऑल अबाउट टुडे, अबाउट व्हिच यू हैव बीन सो क्रिटिकल डॉक्टर तिवारी इन योर ओपनिंग रिमार्क्स. बट द एडवांसमेंट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी एंड एडवेंट ऑफ न्यू मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म्स, the scene is not that depressing. The advancements of technology and advent of new media platforms with relatively low operational cost has led to rise of certain dissenting news portals like the Wire, the Scroll, and to an extent the Print. These media houses have maintained from stringently anti-government to objectively critical instance and have managed to survive with the help of new revenue structures like crowdfunding and gratis from the public intellectuals and personalities. This has helped them retain what they would prefer calling their objectivity. Their rise has also been sustained and helped by the new tools of digital media marketing. Since these entities don't look forward to government for any kind of revenue support, they don't either feel obliged to support the government. Thus we may just be witnessing rise of alternative voices to maintain balance. As Supreme Court bench of Justice Sawant and Justice Mohan had stated, there is an inescapable interconnection between freedom of speech and the stability of society, that is stability of a nation state. They contribute to each other. Ours is a nascent republic and we are yet to achieve the goal of a stable society. So the Supreme Court order was so clear that we need to have a stable society, we need to have a what you call a we need to have a society which would be stable and give space to one and all, so there is balance. So the rise of technology has also made the major media houses owning newspapers and television channels to convert their products into online entities. Sare akhbar, sare television sab ke aaj ke tarikh mein news portals. और खास करके इस कोविड के टाइम में तो ये न्यूज पोर्टल्स ने ही उनको अलाइव रखा, अदरवाइज इट वुड नॉट हैव बीन पॉसिबल फॉर देम टू सर्वाइव. द राइज ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी, इनफैक्ट मेनी ऑफ दिस न्यूज़पेपर पोर्टल्स हैव क्रिएटेड व्हाट आर कॉल्ड पे वॉल्स नाउ, दैट यू हैव टू पे टू एंटर दोज न्यूज पोर्टल्स एंड कंज्यूम न्यूज, यू कैन नॉट कंज्यूम इट फॉर फ्री. So that's what, when I said in the beginning that they were trying to create models of financial models, financial survival. So these are the kind of models which are coming into play. Now there's something called absence of expertise. One of the biggest problems which COVID has pointed towards is that our media persons are not equipped to report on health issues. Our media persons are not equipped to report on as serious an issue as COVID-19. There is so much of information coming. There is so much of information to be shared. but there is lack of expertise. And this, and in a recent post, Professor Sudhir Kumar Gupta of the prestigious All India Institute of Medical Sciences wrote, media should take a note that medical issues and medical data are very specialized science and need deep understanding and training to be credible in the in reporting in public domain and interest. So, aap kya likh rahe hain, kya bhej rahe hain? And WHO ne isko define kiya hai as infodemic. Overabundance of information, some accurate and some not, that makes it hard for people to find trustworthy sources and reliable guidance when they need it. You know, all kinds of news are coming. Hum nimbu khaye ya narangi khaye ya aam khaye, covid ko kaun harayega pata nahi. All this kind of news is coming today. So this is what has been defined by WHO as infodemic. As we have discussed before, in Indian media, the focus has been on political news and everything else has got dovetailed into interests of rival ideologies and political interests. Absence of expert health and science reporters, there are few in some of the leading newspapers who could be trusted, but largely the absence of trusted health reporters has created a crisis of information. And unfortunately, in media school, ironically, in the media school, we have a whole paper on health communication, a whole paper on health journalism. But when the students go out seeking for job in media houses, nobody is ever recruited as health reporter. There are few newspapers who have health reporters, specialized health reporters. Times of India has one, maybe Hindu has one. Not everybody. Hindustan Times has one that I can read. But not a long-term expert or really experts on the matter. We are full of political reporters. What has made this situation worse is the complete ignorance of television anchors about disease and the virus and their inability to engage into fruitful conversations, even if they have experts on the panel as guests to discussion. Our anchors work through earphones. They have earphones and they have a man sitting behind in the control room who keeps telling them to ask questions. So when your engagement with the, what you call, with the expert is to be dictated by somebody behind, when it is not natural, so there cannot be a very fruitful engagement either. So that is the problem which is witnessed in the television. And additionally, with the rise of social media, the surfeit of not so trustworthy news has been like never before. WhatsApp news, this portal news, that portal news, isko trust kare. So this has created the Hamletian dilemma before us. Hamlet, the famous Shakespearean character. Hamletian dilemma before us is not only about to trust or not to trust, but it has extended to whom do we trust, what do we not trust. Facts are getting interpreted not necessarily according to grammar of a pandemic, but by the syntax of isms, rightist, leftist, centrist, you know, all kinds of isms. So an information about the virus, its spread, its containment, its economic fallout is all getting evaluated on the whetstone of political alignment. You know, if you are a very senior journalist, a very, very senior journalist once came out with a list of chief ministers who are doing a great job. It included the name of Mr. Arvind Kejriwal, who was doing a great job, and it did not include the name of the chief minister of Goa. Today, probably Goa remains the only corona-free state, and what has happened to Delhi, you see. So this is called the political alignment of the reporters, media persons. You are just blindfolded. You are not ready to look beyond your ideological affiliations. And this is a very, very sad situation. So, you know, and when such news is being, you know, being sent to you know, the kind of news which I mentioned to you, you're giving certificates, he is good, he is bad, he is this, he is that. So this kind of information, which is not, you know, very credible information, worse than credible information. There was this French philosopher, Harry Frankfurt. In 2005, he wrote a paper where he defined this kind of dissemination of information as bullshit. He actually said in his research paper that this kind of information is bullshit. He said, bullshit can be differentiated from both from honest statements and from lies. Honest statements are grounded in belief that they are true, and lies are grounded in belief that they are not true. Bullshit, on the other hand, concerns statements made with little or no concern for their truth value. हमारे पास कोई फॉरवर्ड आया, हमने फॉरवर्ड कर दिया, हमने सोचा ही नहीं कि ये इसका ट्रूथ वैल्यू क्या है. We are becoming messengers of information without really realizing that what we are disseminating is true or not true. So next time when you do that, you realize that this gentleman called Harry Frankfurt said that whatever you are forwarding, you are probably forwarding a bullshit. So be very, very careful next time when you blindly forward an information which lands on your mobile phone. Now this loss of credibility from being a very, very respectable media to a, you know, Thomas Jefferson, I'm very sure there must be here students and teachers of political science. US President Thomas Jefferson, a very famous political scientist also, he said about press in his time, 19th century, when the press is free and every man able to read, all is safe. Well, that is what Jefferson had to say. And what Harry Frankfurt has to say, we all have heard. So the change has happened from credible media to a bullshitting media. And this has been defined in the arena of mass communication studies. Now, why is this happening? This is happening because of ideological divide, information war. The discussion in media ecosystem of late has focused on governments taking a stern view of those not amenable towards its programs and policies. Over the years, we have witnessed that this phenomenon becomes dominant in times and phases when opposition gains in strength. The most famous of the cases is the one between owner of Indian Express, Ramnath Goenka, and Indira Gandhi. You know, the whole fight that they had during emergency, how the press was shut down, how there were notices, tax raids and everything. So that happened then. And now we have the cases of NDTV and the Republic TV. Now NDTV and Republic TV cases very, very different from Goenka's case. Goenka was a born dissenter. Goenka carried two hoods. You know, when the electricity was cut to his press, he printed his, and when was a union strike done in his press, he printed newspapers, his daily edition in Chandigarh press and brought it and distributed it. So he was a man with a mission and a passion. But the people today are businessmen. The ideological alignment of the two channels, for that matter, several others too, are obvious. Known for their proximity to Congress and ideological opposition to BJP, NDTV has faced tax and other financial irregularity notices from the various arms of the government. Similarly, there are channels which have received support from government for taking pro-establishment stand. In a scenario of such ideological divide, information cannot remain knowledge. Knowledge as in communicated or received concerning a particular fact or circumstance. It is the plain knowledge what is coming to you through these channels. It is colored knowledge which is coming to you. On the other hand, so what we are now faced with is disinformation and misinformation. These are two concepts in mass communication, disinformation and misinformation. Misinformation is a false information. Misinformation, you have misinformed. False information which you have spread not really with a desire to spread falsehood. Whereas disinformation is something that you know very well that this is false, but you spread that information to create a narrative for your client. That is disinformation. So this whole misinformation, disinformation, bullshit, this all is happening because of the ideological war that we are facing in media today. And this is all happening. You can blame the government, you can blame the media house, you can blame the, but who are the tools who are doing this? The tools are the reporters, the news persons, the persons who are actually handling the mic and the pen. So my thing, to my understanding, the biggest threat to credibility of media today comes from within its physiological organs. From being faceless bylines coming out of scoops, a reporter today believes in being a celebrity. An article in Millennium Post makes an interesting observation. It says, first and foremost, a news person should never become news. He should report the news. The challenge is not to score high on TRP or about holding a better media trial. The challenge is whose report would people as in common apolitical people, refer to with greater confidence. And this feedback can never come by raising a storm on social media. The feedback is part of the respect and affection, not awe, that one earns as a reporter from being spending years in the trade of news. The reporters of today, however, have bitten the bug of being an influencer on social media. You see, we have a person whose name had figured very prominently in Radia case, Radia tape cases also. She was going all over the country holding a mic and saying that I'm a corona warrior, I'm doing great service to the country, bringing to you corona news. But what I have really seen are images of he holding a mic, he hugging people, he being giving solace to people, comfort to people. What we are getting to see are her image promotions rather than any story about media, any real story about media. Has she been able to break this kind of story which we saw, where a child is put on a briefcase and pulled along by mother? No, she did not do so. Because all the while, the focus of the camera has been on herself. And such kind of journalism, borders onto what can we call narcissism. So narcissist media, we are also now faced with challenge of narcissist media. Plus this narcissism extends to being, how much following you have on Twitter, how much following you have on Facebook. Do you have a Facebook page? There are reporters who at least care a damn about the impact their story may have had next morning, what they do, what they care about, that how many trawlers followed them, what their two-line comments, what kind of response it had to that. The irresponsible journalism, by this responsibility. So in their whole desire to become celebrities and influencers, which again, influencer is again a digital media marketing terminology. Influencer kya hota hai? Jo aapko batata hai ki aap kaun sa sabun kharidiye, kaun sa soap kharidiye, kaun sa surf kharidiye, kaun sa fashion designer ke paas jaiye. That is the influencer on social media. But here we have news persons on social media who are giving all kinds of opinions. So the reporter's credibility is getting overtaken by these reporters designing and trying to become influencers, which is bringing them a lot of distrust and discredit. I think I've spoken for more than an hour, and I have told you issues and topics which are the reasons which have brought discredit to our media because of the close scrutiny. People want to consume news, which is good news, which is palatable news, which is, useful news, which can create a social impact, news which can force government to make policy changes. But here in this case, we have a situation where people are, sucking up to their political masters, to their corporate clients. And so this creates a very sad situation. But social media has also provided us a platform where a lot of people are blogging, a lot of people are writing, a lot of people are bringing in information in public domain, which traditional media houses have failed to do that. With these words, I want to end my deliberation. I would say that catharsis for our media lies in rising above dissemination of information with prefixes of misinformation and disinformation, and overcome the desire to be a celebrity. Thank you so much, Kusha ji and everybody else, for suffering me for about an hour. I had so much to speak, so I spoke.
No, sir, it was it was really, really, you know, informative, as well as you have really given an insider's view of how media works, how news channels work, how online portal or the entire system is used or misused, you know, time and again. And it was really nice because you've touched upon a lot of, a lot of controversial cases also centered around media, and how, and you have actually put forth questions and you have talked about challenges. But there are some questions coming in from the participants there that are asking for solutions. So they're asking for solutions, and you must look at the chat room. There have been almost more than 300 comments for you, and they're very heartening. They all have really liked the session and praised it, and really want the recording of the session also. So which we are actually recording the session. We are going to put it on the college website for everybody's, anyone can go and check there. Sir, can I put forth some questions?
Yes, yes, please.
Participants have asked.
Yes,
okay.
Yes,
so the first question is that, you know, what according to you, or which according to you is the best news channel presently, you know, in terms of objectively giving the news? That's one question that has come.
Okay. 9 o'clock, no news channel gives news. 9 o'clock in the night, when is the time to see news? No news channel gives news. What it gives is prime time debates, whatever they call. Now, हमारे भारतीय संस्कृति में, in our Indian culture, there has been a concept of evening panchayaton mein, gramin jagah mein, we have had cock fights and we have had goat fights. So what we are having witnessing on these news channels are, वो कहते हैं शब्द वीर नाम वर्ड वॉरियर्स यू नो रैकिंग अप हेड्स ऑफ ईच अदर. सो इफ यू आस्क मी फ्रैंकली, फॉर लास्ट सेवरल इयर्स आई हैव नॉट वॉच्ड न्यूज चैनल्स. आई डोंट इंटेंड वॉचिंग न्यूज चैनल्स. ऑन द अदर हैंड, ऑल थ्रू द डे दैट आई एम मूविंग अराउंड, आई डू लॉट ऑफ ट्रैवलिंग अराउंड द सिटी, आई डू लॉट, आई ऑलवेज हैव माय एफएम न्यूज चैनल ऑन एंड आई कीप लिसनिंग टू रेडियो न्यूज, बिकॉज रेडियो न्यूज गिव्स यू न्यूज. And I'm sorry, I cannot say this for the channels. Channels, as I said, they are all politically aligned today. No channel can be said to be giving a view which is not ideologically colored. So you watch them with this at the back of your mind. You all are intelligent people to know, ye kiski pairvi kar raha hai, whose case he's speaking. So if you're asking for a, if you are asking me to play a digital media influencer and recommend to you a channel, I would recommend to you none. Yes, the next
question basically is, you know, it's about a particular news channel. So someone has asked, you know, what about the objectivity of NDTV channel? You may answer or you may skip if you want.
I have no problems. I've been a loud mouth all my life. I have no problems on that count. NDTV ke political inclinations evident hai. Republic TV ke political inclinations evident hai. NDTV ki kabiliyat ye hai ki they are very subtle and they are much smarter than the man who heads the, although he has also come out from NDTV stable, the Republic wala. But you know, they are smarter people. They make it in a very, very presentable way, very, you know, full of etiquettes and manners and everything. But again, I'm sorry, they are also not above suspicion. As again, you know, which I keep quoting from Shakespeare, even NDTV is not above suspicion. Mr. Kumar, what's his name? Who got the Magashishi Award. He's also not above suspicion. They all are pursuing some kind of a political agenda, and very blatantly on their channels, and largely because there are no regulations.
So next question is, I think electronic media is dominating the traditional media. the e-medias are largely becoming business platforms for the capitalist. So a good journalist also is bound to be biased, otherwise he will lose his job. So how can we revive media?
The first thing was that television channel is the channel. Television channel is the what? Could you come back again? That what did you say? The television channel is the are the main media today.
Saying that electronic media has dominated the traditional media, the journalist also has to be biased because otherwise they lose their job.
I don't agree with this question. Television. After you would find it very difficult to believe that once the economy opened, once technology revolution renaissance happened in this country, the print media has grown by leaps and bounds. So newspaper circulation have went up in last two decades. So there was television, but the print media circulation has gone up by leaps and bounds. Newspapers like Amar Ujala, which was one Agra newspaper, has today 20 editions. Jagran, which was a Kanpur paper, has another 15-20 editions. Dainik Bhaskar, which was again a Bhopal newspaper, today is DB Corp, one of the biggest news corporations of the world. So print media has grown by leaps and bounds. So please, if you have not been reading newspapers, don't say that electronic media is dominating traditional media. Newspapers till actually coming of the COVID have had a very, very dominant role, and they have been the newsrooms also have been. Do you know in 24 hours news channels, the actual news component is only 8 hours and baki sare rerun hote. To ye jo aap raat bhar koi naya khabar nahi dikhate ho, subah jab akhbar ko padh kar ke hi wo apna news agenda bhi tay karte hain din ka. So newspapers have remained till date the agenda setters as far as newspaper industry goes, as far as media industry goes. Unfortunately, COVID has created a situation where newspapers are not accessible, but they are now getting accessed by what you call the portals that they have created. As far as you know, like it's like this: you become a doctor, you join a nursing home, where you are being asked to trade in kidney, and you say, "If I don't trade in kidney, I will lose my job." What would you do? So similarly, for a journalist. If you are being asked to trade in fake news and you say that if I don't trade in fake news, I will lose my job, God bless you. I can just say that.
Okay, so next question is fake news and propaganda making damage to society. What is your suggestion to citizens? Should they keep away from such news? If so, where are they going to get the genuine news?
You see, citizens, when a citizen asks such a question, I understand the citizens of this country are pretty intelligent people. And what I talked to you about when I gave you concepts of bullshit, misinformation, disinformation, what I meant to you was that what keep your reading to keep it to a limited reading, number one. Number two, keep it to quality reading. The established brands, the established known brands, known. Keep it to that. And for heaven's sake, stop getting into the business of blindly forwarding. कुछ भी आया हमारे फोन पे हमने अपने ग्रुप पे फॉरवर्ड कर दिया. इसको बंद कीजिए प्लीज. किसने लिख के भेज दिया कि दिल्ली पुलिस ने कहा है कि मास्क मत पहनिए क्योंकि उससे ऑक्सीजन. Yesterday I received it. दिल्ली पुलिस ने कहा है कि मास्क मत पहनिए क्योंकि इससे वो ऑक्सीजन मिलना बंद हो जाता है. कैन यू एवर थिंक दिल्ली पुलिस सेइंग सच अ थिंग? कैन दिल्ली पुलिस एवर से दैट डोंट वेयर मास्क? बट पीपल आर फॉरवर्डिंग इट एंड इट हैज बीन फॉरवर्डेड अ लैक टाइम्स. सो यू हैव टू गेट आउट ऑफ दिस रट ऑफ फॉरवर्डिंग इंफॉर्मेशन विच इज कमिंग टू यू. दिस इन्फोडेमिक, व्हाट WHO कॉल्ड दिस इन्फोडेमिक, यू नो, यू हैव टू वेट इट आउट ऑफ दिस. And you can contribute to it. Each citizen, each consumer of news information can contribute by, you know, as in corona, we are stopping spread of infection by stopping it from at one place. Similarly, this infection of spread of fake news can be stopped by not forwarding such news, you know. And of course, you have to use your intelligence. your discerning powers to know what is fake news and what is not fake news.
Next question is, I think probably I'll take this last question, though there are more pouring in. A single incident has been presented in different ways in different channels and newspapers. How could a common person get the right news? What exactly is the right news?
That is the problem which our consumer faces today. That how does one really check out on, and that is the crisis of credibility in the Indian media. There is so much of pressure on the Indian media today that it is giving out that it has got into propaganda mode. That is the disease that I talked about. And that disease is, you see, it is very easy. How do you, let's take the Shaheen Bagh protest, which has been differently interpreted by different groups. Now, there was a protest. It got entangled into the right and the left battle. What was the protest about? How many consumers of the news and how many opinion givers of the news would be able to say what was this protest about? What was this whole issue about? What is the protest? Why are they protesting? So we as consumers of news should go beyond news, should go and read about it. You see, like the CAA, this whole protest was there. These are there, the whole act is there. Their academic interpretations are there. You can go there and understand for yourself. There is no need for you to be bought over by any particular newspaper or any particular news channel. In fact, in my school days, we were prescribed in our Hindi classes a poem called Karamveer by Hari Om Upadhyay Hariyot. So that poem said, ki Karamveer sunte hai sabki karte hai apne man ki. So that is how you should be a Karamveer. You should listen to everybody, but then decide for yourself. And you have to use your intelligence to decide for yourself. Nobody can cure you for that. Nobody can give you a cure for that. It is you who have to decide for yourself that what is correct and what is not correct.
Thank you, sir. If you allow me, then I'll take one more question.
Please.
Yes, sir, if you allow me.
Please, I'm most welcome.
Okay. There is a question about the news anchors. You know, it says due to a lot of political pressure, news anchors are removed from their jobs. The person is naming news channels like Aaj Tak and ABP News. So what do you think, how can this pressure be dealt with specifically by young reporters who are just coming into the profession, holding on to their ethics probably and then facing the real world of media?
भाई एक यंग रिपोर्टर को नौकरी से कोई नहीं हटाता. अ यंग रिपोर्टर हैज टू बिकम अ रियल टाइम बिग रिपोर्टर एंड अ बिग नेम टू इनवाइट दैट काइंड ऑफ अ रैथ ऑन वनसेल्फ. आपने कभी सुना कि कभी पुलिस में जो पॉलिटिकल पोस्टिंग्स होती है वो एसपी की होती है, जिले के डीसीपी की होती है? कभी सुना कि किसी बीट कॉन्स्टेबल के पीछे कोई पॉलिटिकल रीजन से उसको हटाया गया? यू सी, फॉर बडिंग रिपोर्टर्स, your boss, your chief reporter at 5 o'clock in the evening is going to ask you, khabar kya hai tumhare paas, what is news? He's not going to ask you for your opinion. Aaj agar Amit Shah wahan gaye the Lalit LNJP hospital, Lok Nayak Jayaprakash hospital, to wahan unhone kya measures liye, iske bare mein aapse puchega from his young reporter in front, the man on the ground. He will not ask you that center-state relationship. They will not ask you on that. He is interested in what steps the government is taking. Because today the reader in the morning is more interested in knowing ki how his life is going to be saved. So the young people who are joining the profession of news should keep this worry aside. Your first and foremost job is to gather information, to bring information and disseminate information. वो कलर देने का काम इंफॉर्मेशन को वो आपके एडिटर साहब का वो लोग करते हैं और एडिटरों की ही नौकरी जाती है पॉलिटिकल प्रेशर में, रिपोर्टरों की नौकरी पॉलिटिकल प्रेशर में नहीं जाती. अनलेस एंड अंटिल रिपोर्टर ने कुछ वैसे ही कुछ हरकत कर दी हो तो वो अलग बात, दैट्स समथिंग डिफरेंट.
So yes, my only exposure to such incident is that film called Page 3. So editor keeps his job while the reporter loses it.
You see, I will tell you one thing. The air, but if you come to real life, in the case of Radia case, the editor also kept the job and the reporter also kept the job. Both managed to keep the job. That is why Indian media is in such a crisis. So reporters, at times, I must tell you, reporters at times have walked out of a newspaper, of a news organization, because the editor decided not to carry the story for political reasons. And then the reporter said that, and that was totally for ethical reasons. So that is fully justified. He decides to quit on his own. But because this is not acceptable, I cannot do stories like this, I cannot do a job like this, and one can walk out. So that's something very, very ethical. And there are instances in newspaper industry full of such stories. If you have seen this film on Balasaheb, on Thackeray, he's a cartoonist there, So, he makes a cartoon and goes and gives it. The editor is very annoyed with him, so he makes this cartoon. So he goes and gives a cartoon to him, and when he opens, he receives that it's a resignation letter which he has written in his cartoon. So there are people like this in journalism. There have been people, passionate people in journalism, who have stood by their stories, and there have also been editors who have stood by their reporters. At least I can say, for 18 years I worked in Pioneer newspaper, for 12 years I had somebody called Chandan Mitra as my editor, who was a BJP inclined person, where I was not at all a BJP inclined person, and he stood me whenever I did stories against the BJP also. So there are examples like that also. So yes, Page 3 to theek hai, lekin waqai kuch aise strong reporters bhi hote hain, editors bhi hote hain, jo apne reporter ke liye stand lete hain, who stand by their reporters. And there are reporters, when they find, it is like this, that in army, in defense, on front, if the commanding officer is not able to command respect of the soldiers, he will never be able to deliver. So agar editor bahut hi zyada agar wo compromised hoga, to reporter laake story nahi dega, to fir akhbar mein chhapega kya, news mein dikhayega kya wo. So he also needs information, he needs news. After all, at the end, in the morning, he has to sell a product, and he needs content for that. And if he starts killing every good story, then maybe tomorrow no story he will have in the newspaper. So that is how it generally works in the newspaper.
Thank you, sir, for such interesting and interactive session, and specifically the Q&A session. Thank you so much. I can only add one thing, which is that due to the lockdown and this pandemic, we are all deprived of Ekta Kapoor's soap operas. So this is the only soap opera that's available to us at the moment, these 24 hours news channels, and we are thoroughly enjoying that. We are enjoying, instead of looking at those all decked up women in Ekta Kapoor serials, we are looking at reporters who are focusing the camera on themselves while reporting about the migrant crisis. So that's enjoyable. That's there are some light moments. We try to unwind with them. So thanks to the COVID warriors, the media COVID warriors, that there is some entertainment, at least that live entertainment actually, that we are able to be part of. Thank you so much
Kusha ji, before we end, I must also add that, we have talked, but there have been people like veteran photographer, photojournalist Praveen Jain, and who now works for print. They have actually traveled and brought up, and Praveen actually got infected with, and he was in quarantine in Ahmedabad for about 10 days. And he has actually produced great photos of the COVID, whereas his own photo has not appeared anywhere. So he is a man of the year, you know, and you actually need to emulate examples like that of Praveen Jain than anybody else.
Sir, I have a question. It's a query, you can say, sir, if you permit me.
Yes, sir, please.
I'm a bit curious in knowing, sir, nowadays, does this media schools also, you know, prepare the students, you know, by imparting some kind of acting skills also?
This is a very interesting question. You see, in my school of mass communication, we now don't call it journalism, we call it mass communication. और मास कम्युनिकेशन के स्कूल में जो रुझान है आज के जनरेशन का, इट इज लीस्ट टुवर्ड्स जर्नलिज्म. आई मस्ट टेल यू दिस, दैट आउट ऑफ द 300, इफ 50-60 स्टूडेंट्स ऑप्ट फॉर इन दैट प्लेसमेंट प्रेफरेंसेस दैट दे गिव, इफ दे ऑप्ट फॉर मीडिया, एंड दैट इज ऑल्सो अ पैरामीटर यू कैन से एज ऑफ द क्राइसिस ऑफ क्रेडिबिलिटी ऑफ मीडिया, नॉट मोर देन 50-60 पीपल, दैट मीन्स 10-20% are opting for media. Rest all are either going for filmmaking, television as in entertainment television, filmmaking, digital media, social media, digital media marketing, event management. So that worries me that the interest of students towards media is, stress of students of mass communication and journalism towards media is actually on a very big low today. And hope that, and this is because of crisis of credibility in media. If you listen to their talk, are yaar media mein jaakar kya karu? And these intelligent people, when they go to filmmaking, they end up making, you know, serials like Panchayat, which you are seeing, and there are other good serials. The quality, and you know, Netflix, This streaming channels has given them such a big platform today for their creativity. They don't have to be latching on to any production house or any media house of Bollywood or anything. They can make their own producers and send it to Netflix and get it. So there was this movie which was released on one of the streaming channels, Chintu Ka Birthday, made by two absolutely unknown people by very small production house, but what a great film. And they did not need a Yash Raj production or a Dharma production or a Vinod or a Mahesh Bhatt production or a RK studios to release them. So platform is, when I say of social media platform, it is just not limited to news. It is also this. But as far as you're talking about this anchoring, हम तो नहीं सिखाते, लेकिन टेलीविजन के अंदर जब वो जाते हैं तो फिर वो थोड़ा वहां पे तो उनको मैनिपुलेट करते हैं कि आप ऐसे करो, वैसे बोलो, ये करो, और साइलेंट भी कर देते हैं जब कोई कुछ उनके मतलब की बात नहीं बोल रहा, तो साइलेंट भी कर देते हैं. इट हैपेंस दैट.
थैंक यू सर, सच ए नाइस वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन, सच ए नाइस क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन. इट वाज वेरी वेरी नॉट ओनली प्रोडक्टिव इन्फॉर्मेटिव, इट इज वेरी वेल रिसीव्ड आल्सो. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. It was really, really very, very useful also, and practically relevant for the audiences to hear about whatever challenges that are faced by the media, Indian media specifically, in current times, and what are the ways in which There is still some genuine journalism left. We actually need to see for ourselves. Intelligent audiences, intelligent viewers can actually make out what is politically motivated and what exactly is unbiased news. So thank you so much for answering all the questions and for the wonderful session. Thank you. I would like to ask our principal, sir, to finally give concluding remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Kursha. It was not only very, very informative, as you said very correctly, it was very, very useful. And I I see it as very, very productive, because I could see a lot of boarding journalists, a lot of students also will be, you know, worried about their next course of action. As far as career progression is concerned, they are also very intently listening. And the way Professor Mishra was explaining everything and giving us a very, very useful insight. And he has just very lucidly presented before us a sketch of the media houses and how do they operate. And instantly we can, you know, get connected with the way the media is operating and the way it is being now functioning, and the COVID crisis also. Everything he has done very lucidly, and I hope from here also a lot of things can be, we can take away and connect it further. And I could impress upon you to, you know, build up something. A lot of researchers are also sitting here. Lot of advertising initiatives also Professor Mishra has already discussed. And lot of insights he has given. Lot of researchers, they can take a lot of ideas from this. So with these words, once again, I thank profusely. And we are very, very grateful, sir, for agreeing to this and for such a wonderful session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for very apt concluding remarks. I would like to thank all the members of the organizing committee, IQAC and WDC, for organization of this webinar. Specifically, I would like to thank our student members, Anshuman Sharma and Anshad Gupta, for helping us out during this webinar and also in the preparations of this event. I would also like to thank our office staff, specifically our administrative officer, Mr. Jagat Singh Chauhan, who is also our IQAC member, and Mr. Suman Jha for facilitating the entire process and also taking care of the entire technical aspect of this webinar. And also I would like to thank all the participants who have joined us for this webinar, for their encouraging remarks in the chat room. There are plenty, sir. You know, there are almost, as I said, over 300 remarks in the chat room for you. So thank you all the participants for being with us. And there are some participants, sir, who have been with us through all the webinars, I can see. You know, they join all the webinars that SLC has been organizing. Many of them are there in all the events. So thank you all, and hope to see you again with another interesting topic for a seminar or a webinar. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Mishra, for joining us today as a resource person. Thank you.